One of the greatest artists of all time, widely known as Mama Africa, the Empress of Song, one of the most impactful voices to come out of South Africa in the heat of the liberation struggle. Zenzile Miriam Makeba was Africa's first major international singing success. She was the first South African to win a Grammy. And most importantly, she was one of the most prominent critics of South Africa's rigid segregation laws.
In South Africa, there are two separate communities, and that's the white community and the black community. I will speak for my community. I always feel that we as artists should never close our eyes to what is happening around us. We are all Africans. We were just put in different countries by white people who took the people from Africa and spread them out. It just proves to everyone that we just have to keep fighting. We just have to fight that much more.
Miriam Makeba was born in 1932 to Caswell Makeba, who was a teacher, school teacher. He was a Xhosa man. And her mother, Christina Makeba, who was a Swazi woman. She was a sangoma and she was a domestic worker. She also brewed and sold mqombothi as a side hustle because it was really hard for black people to make ends meet in those times because of apartheid. Very few job opportunities for black people. Mqombothi, for those who don't know, is a traditional South African beer. It's a very beautiful part of South African heritage, which is still very much alive in various aspects of South African culture. I only highlight the significance of that because colonizers worked really hard to eradicate our culture in general for hundreds of years, especially during apartheid. Like, mqombothi was illegal to drink or sell or brew. When Christina was caught brewing mqombothi, she was thrown in prison with her newborn baby. She had just given birth to Miriam. Miriam was 18 days old. So the first 6 months of her life, she was spent being raised in a prison cell. So after her father passed away, she went to live with her grandmother. And her family there was said to be a very musical family. They sang a lot of African traditional music. They were into jazz music. They got her to sing in the choir. I know they encouraged her to sing in the choir in church. History tells that that's where she really got into her love and appreciation for music. She got married to her first husband in 1949 and gave birth to her only child, Bongi Makeba. And it turned out to be a very abusive marriage. It ended after 2 years. And she went on to do domestic work herself. And she also sang on the side as a side hustle. She sang at weddings and funerals to make ends meet for her and her daughter. She was also said to sing for free quite a lot of the time just because she enjoyed it so much. She also joined a jazz group called the Manhattan Brothers. It was all male. She was the only girl, and they sang a mix of South African songs and American songs, like popular American music. They did mixes, singing really dope harmonies that caught the attention of audiences countrywide. People really enjoyed hearing Miriam sing in the group, and the demand to hear her solo grew. So she started to do some solo recordings. The first solo recording she did was called Lovely Lies, and that became the first South African record to chart on the United States Billboard Top 100, landing her on the cover of Drum magazine. That was a huge magazine at the time. She performed for white audiences and black audiences separately because of the segregation at the time. And the general lived experience of the oppression of her people was very present in her music. I mean, she was really good at telling stories of their struggle, and the resonance was really healing to those who knew the pain, and the courage to speak up exposed a lot of the cruelty that her people dealt with. And then some big shot filmmaker from the States, I think, saw her performing and was really intrigued and inspired by her. His name is Lionel R. I can't remember his last name. It's really unprofessional for me to not remember his last name. The only thing that I remember about it is that I can't pronounce it. Rogosin? Rogosin? I'm going to call him Lionel R. So he saw her performing and he was really inspired to incorporate her into his work. He produced an anti-apartheid film called Come Back Africa and he invited Miriam to appear in it. I've checked it out, but I'm not gonna lie, I literally fast forwarded to Miriam's part at the end. She's in like the last 5 minutes and she speaks and she sings and it's just beautiful and she's beautiful and I love her and oh my god, I love her so much. Anyway, I'm getting sidetracked. The film was nominated for Critics' Choice Award. So Lionel arranged for a visa for Miriam to attend the premiere of the film at the Venice Film Festival. Her involvement in the film brought a lot of authenticity to the story. Being a part of the liberation struggle and being there to be a part of the story of her people. It was a really important moment for just awareness. It was a platform for her to spread the word on what was going on in South Africa at the time, because a lot of people's eyes were closed to it. A lot of people didn't know. The South African government was also really good at keeping a lot of the cruelty of the government and the police force hush hush. So a lot of people didn't know the extent of the problem in the country. So while she was living it up in Italy, celebrating this moment, celebrating this platform for speaking on crucial issues, there were people informing the South African government of what she was doing and the things that she was saying. And in the midst of all of it, the Sharpeville massacre took place. That was one of the first events that made international news. Two of Miriam's family members were killed in the Sharpeville massacre. And also around that time, her mother passed away. And when she tried to return to the country to attend her mother's funeral, she was denied entry back into the country. Her passport was stamped invalid and she was outlawed as punishment for criticizing the South African government and for speaking out against apartheid laws. In exile, she had to figure out a way to make ends meet. The film got her international acclaim. So she was now known by many people worldwide and she had the opportunity to travel and perform and book shows. She toured to New York, she toured London, and while she was in London, she met Harry Belafonte. So Harry was an American singer who she became really close with and he became kind of a mentor to her. He helped her record a lot of her first solo records, including Pata Pata, which became a huge hit and pretty much launched her career. He kind of just schooled her in the art of international mainstream music. He encouraged her to sing songs from Latin America, from Israel, just to take advantage of her multilingual talent. And he toured with her, you know, he introduced her to a lot of people. I mean, a lot of people wanted to meet her anyway. People were crazy about Miriam in the States and in Europe. People were crazy about her. Everybody wanted to see her show. Even though they couldn't pronounce a lot of the titles of her songs or couldn't even sing along to a lot of the words in her songs, because she sang mainly in Xhosa and Zulu. And the thing is, she was so graceful. Like, every time I watch Miriam interviews, she's so poised. She carries herself like a princess, like a queen. And she's always smiling, even when she's speaking on the most serious things. Anyway, I'm getting sidetracked. So he toured with her and then they got married, which is so cute because they look really good together and they continued to work together. They recorded music, they performed, and he would introduce her and he always gave these beautiful introductions. Then US President John F. Kennedy requested to meet her, so they went together and she sang for his birthday. She just had A-list fans. Ray Charles was a fan of hers, Miles Davis, Louis Armstrong, Cicely Tyson, Marlon Brando, Nina Simone. She performed with Nina Simone in 1966. She won her first Grammy. And I think what was so crucial about what she represented at the time is the way that she spread the word of her struggle and the struggle of her people in Africa really resonated with the African diaspora in the United States and the African diaspora in Europe, because everybody was essentially going through the same thing. She was talking liberation struggle, and that was exactly the conversation and the struggle within the civil rights movement. And she was there in the heat of the civil rights movement. She participated in a lot of the activism. At some point, she was even married to Stokely Stokely Carmichael, who was one of the leaders of the Black Panther Party. She became the symbol of the bridge between what we refer to as us and them, you know, us Africans on home soil and Africans of the diaspora. She was the reminder at the time that no matter where we are in the world, we are African and we fight together. Harry and Miriam then went their separate ways after a few years. And so then in 1968, she didn't meet Stokely. She had met him before, you know, during all of the civil rights work that they were doing. She got married to him in 1968. And that was kind of the undoing of her career at the time, because white people became really uncomfortable with booking her shows. A lot of white people felt that financing her would be funding the civil rights movement and somehow funding the Black Panther Party, funding that activism. She wasn't able to go back home because she was still outlawed in South Africa, but she was welcome in pretty much every other country on the continent. She was granted citizenship in 10 different countries and she had like 6 different passports. She settled in Guinea for a while. The president of Guinea was really fond of her. A lot of African leaders were actually very, very fond of her. Even Haile Selassie, the emperor of Ethiopia, invited her, and she was the only artist that had been invited to perform. It was the inauguration of the Organization of African Unity. During her time in Guinea, their president offered her the platform to speak to the United Nations as an honorary citizen of Guinea. She spoke up against the apartheid government, and she called for action against the oppressive laws being enforced in her country. She insisted that they stop all trading of firearms with the South African government because all of the firearms were likely to be used against Black women and children. And in retaliation for all of her anti-apartheid speeches at the UN, South Africa banned her records. She lived in exile for over 28 years. And in 1988, she went back to the United States and she released a new album called Sangoma. It was healing chants that were dedicated to her mother, who was a sangoma, that kind of just embraced the musical nature of ngoma music. After Nelson Mandela was released from prison in 1990, he invited Miriam back into the country, and her return was a moment. She was celebrated nationwide. In 1991, she performed in South Africa for the first time in like 31 years. She was named a Goodwill Ambassador to the United Nations. She received honorary doctorates from a bunch of universities, the University of Cape Town, Tunisia, the University of Fort Hare. In 1992, she starred in the film Sarafina, which was a musical that basically centered around the Soweto uprising and the students in that time. That's also the year that she was nominated for her second Grammy for her album Homeland. She also then founded the Makeba Center for Girls, which was a home for orphans. There's just so much content on Miriam and the full life that she lived. She did so much. Her birthday is on the 4th of March. At the time of me filming this, it's in a few days, and she would be turning 89 this year. It's an odd number. It would be cooler to say she'd be turning 90, because that's such a wholesome number, but she'd be turning 89. She's powerful, she's iconic. Her words, her experiences, her work. She is a trailblazer. She really paved the way for a lot of young Black women to know that they can achieve anything with courage and grace, regardless of the obstacles that we face in life, that it's more than possible to overcome and to excel. I'm always inspired by her. Long live Miriam. She never turned down an opportunity to speak for her people and to speak out against her oppressor. I really admire that. Those are characteristics that I try to live by. Don't forget to like, share, comment, and subscribe. Take care of yourselves, everybody. Prioritize yourself. I'll see you in the next video. Bye.